complaining about the woeful state of education in his time. And what he advocates for in these letters or essays is a better reading of both of God's books, both Scripture and creation. He wants a renewed commitment to genuine scholarship within a Christian frame of reference, in which science and faith and Scripture are all of them seriously engaged, contemplated in relation to each other, and sure knowledge of all kinds emerges from that process. And that plea from Roger Bacon then forms the basis for my reflections early on in the paper about our contemporary situation. I speculate that Roger Bacon, were he with us now, would still not be a happy person. And in particular, that he would be appalled, I suspect, by the way in which contemporary Christian faith so often keeps science and Scripture at arm's length from each other, and indeed, in many quarters, regards them as being at war with each other, as if Scripture and creation were not the two books of God at all. And I offer my own opinion that he would be right to be appalled. Scripture and creation cannot be coherently conceived of within the Christian tradition as being at odds with each other. Biblical exegesis cannot be allowed to reside in a state of war with scientific reading of creation or vice versa. And I propose, in fact, that although it's quite common for modern people, both outside and inside the church, to assume that the warfare model of faith and science to which they presently adhere has characterized the entirety of Christian reflection on this kind of thing, that this is actually not true. I would say it's not true at all, broadly speaking. Roger Bacon has many important friends in the tradition who, like him, have combined a high view of Scripture and its reliability as God's word to us with a resolute commitment to integrating scriptural teaching with truth discovered from creation. And by way of progressing that argument, I turn in the first instance to St. Augustine. And in that section of the paper, I begin by reviewing Augustine's high view of Scripture, but also his conviction, in line with the Church Fathers more generally, that while Scripture does wish to address us about a number of important truths, it also does not wish to address us about others. In particular, I draw attention to Augustine's criticism of Christians who read Scripture itself in order to subvert what he calls the knowledge of present objects, which in his view, we corporately already possess on account of, quote, the testimony of our own senses. That's the way he actually puts it. For Augustine, there is such a thing as knowledge common to all educated people, Christian or not, and it is known by way of reason and experience. And Augustine does not believe that anyone should cite the sacred authors of Scripture, as he puts it, in order to overturn such empirically and rationally grounded knowledge. Now, one of the reasons he thinks we shouldn't do this is because it will undermine the credibility of what the biblical authors have to say about their matters of central concern, which he characterizes as the resurrection of the dead, the hope of eternal life, and the kingdom of heaven. That he needs to say that, of course, reveals that other people took a different view. There were apparently those who already believed in the patristic period that a scripture that was perfect must at the same time comprise a kind of God-breathed encyclopedia of all knowledge. And at that point in the paper, I briefly discuss the Christian apologist Lactantius, 3rd and 4th centuries, and his attack on the idea that the world is round like a ball, like a globe. He was very much against that idea. But on the whole, writers in this period of church history did not take an all-encompassing view of what Scripture is intended to reveal. By and large, the Church Fathers acknowledged that inspired, perfect Scripture was designed only to answer infallibly certain kinds of questions and not other ones. I then pass on the paper to the magisterial reformers who followed the church fathers in believing that one of the implications of the coexistence of the divine and human word in Scripture is the reality of divine accommodation. There are truths that God wishes to communicate to us, but this divine communication must attend to the capacities of the recipients. This is a particularly important theme in John Calvin's thought, I argue, such that, as Ford Battles says, any study of Calvin as scriptural exegete would be incomplete, which failed to examine his frequent appeal to the principle of accommodation. And I introduce at that point a number of examples of how this works out in Calvin's writings, especially emphasizing his generally open attitude toward the results of contemporary scientific endeavor. I then draw attention also to Luther's similar openness to many of the scientific advances of his day, mechanical, medical, and of other kinds, noting Luther's conviction that the reform of religion, in particular, the retrieval of truer versions of the doctrines of creation and incarnation, would lead people to take nature more seriously and appreciate it more fully than had been possible, he thought, under the rule of either the medieval scholastics or unreformed humanists like Erasmus. So he was very upbeat about the potentiality of reformed religion actually increasing our attentiveness to creation. I also draw attention in this part of the paper to just how many Protestants in particular in the immediately succeeding period dedicated themselves specifically to the acquisition of scientific knowledge, seeing it as part of their Christian vocation. And I cite there, for example, Johannes Kepler. I wanted to become a theologian, and for a long time I was restless. Now, however, observe how through my scientific effort God is being celebrated in astronomy. The important point about all of this is that there was a general openness to scientific inquiry in the Protestant Church of the 16th century, and what it has to offer humanity in terms of both teaching and blessing, and that this openness has all too often not been replicated in subsequent Protestant theology and practice. And I argue that the main example often cited by advocates of the warfare model in favor of a closed Protestant attitude towards the reading of creation, namely the reception of the emerging Copernican theory, does not hold up under critical scrutiny. In fairness, I just said I argued that point. I didn't. I footnoted that point. The argument's in the book. So I had to cut. This leads me on next to consider the relationship between Protestant views of scripture and science in the 17th century, at the beginning of what Hans Fry has called the eclipse of biblical narrative, by which he means the period of history in which what had been Christendom, an entire pre-modern world defined by and organized in terms of the biblical narrative, that world is disappearing in this century and a new world, a modern world, is emerging. And I note there that one popular contemporary Christian response to this eclipse of biblical narrative is to present it largely as a story of unjustifiable apostasy. I consider that to be an inadequate response because it finds no role for the Protestant Church itself other than in capitulating to falsehood, no other role in causing the eclipse. Yet I argue in this section of the paper that the 17th century Protestant Church did in fact play a role in the eclipse by often adopting an unnecessarily defensive position when it came to questions of faith and science. The pro-Copernican Galileo is usually remembered, by Protestants at least, as having been assailed by Rome specifically, and his heresy trial in 1633 has of course become emblematic of intolerant religious prejudice when confronted with scientific data. But I point out that the first anti-Copernican monograph to appear in the Lutheran sphere, that of Danish mathematician and theologian Peter Bartholinus, had already appeared in the previous year, 1632. And this is reflective of a trend. a trend away in some quarters from the approach of reformers like Luther and Calvin to matters of faith, science, and scripture. It's not the only trend. Many important 17th century Protestants clearly stood in line with Luther and Calvin on such matters. Many agreed with Galileo, for example, when he himself referenced divine accommodation in scripture in relation to the Copernican issue. And I introduce a number of important figures along that line at that point in the paper. But in the long run, unfortunately, it's the anti-group rather than the supporting or affirming group who are most often remembered when the story of science and faith in the 17th century is told. It's remembered both by Christians and by others who agree with them that the warfare model of the history of science and faith is the correct model. On that, people otherwise antagonistic to each other absolutely agree. And so what people see when they look at the history of this period is not the Christian Bible readers who attempted to integrate new scientific knowledge into the framework of Christian truth claims, revisiting older interpretations of the Bible that were problematic in pursuit of accommodation. That's not what people see typically. What they see is people determined to dismiss new scientific knowledge in order to avoid any disturbance to older ways of understanding certain things. This brings me next in the paper to the Age of Enlightenment in the 18th century, where the fork in the road of Protestant hermeneutics that I've just described propelled onwards the two ways of approaching the subject matter that I've just been describing, and did so in interesting and significant ways. At this point, I introduce, on the side of what we might call the integrationists, the important figure of Jonathan Edwards, who lived from 1703 till 1758. And I spend some time discussing his life and work. Edwards, once again, was someone who, in the word of one author, was, quote, quite willing to acknowledge the epistemological and perceptual limitations of the biblical narratives and to transform his interpretation of them accordingly, end quote. Such appropriate reinterpretation was indeed an important aspect of resolving the problem of the growing conflict in the 18th century between scripture texts and science. And Edwards was very upbeat, very optimistic, very enthusiastic. In fact, had he been able to do some of the things he wanted to do so enthusiastically, he would probably have blown himself up and killed himself before we even got to the thing that he's mainly remembered for. Some of his ideas, I'm afraid, would have caused him damage had he had the means to pursue them. But anyway, Edwards was by no means alone in the English-speaking world as the closing decades of the 18th century gave way to the opening decades of the 19th. And I spend a little time in the paper showing that this was so. And although this is not in the paper, my Regent College colleague Bruce Hindmarsh is currently writing a book on evangelical spirituality in this time period, and has some very interesting things to say about John Wesley, for example, in this regard as well. So there's just an awful lot of stereotypes here, which turn out, when subject to the cold light of historical analysis, simply not to be true about what the story is. This brings me in the next section of the paper to the 19th and 20th centuries. We're moving along quickly. I draw attention, first of all, to the challenge posed by geology, of course, in the 19th century, in the course of which it became widely understood all over the world that the Earth is the product of a very long historical process. And I explore how educated Protestant Bible readers responded to this challenge. Strong affirmations of traditional young Earth cosmology in many quarters in the first instance, followed by a lively debate in Britain and in the US on this question of the age of the Earth and how it came to be as it is now, about the correct way to read both scripture and creation. And then, as the strength of the new scientific evidence came to be more widely accepted, new proposals emerging and being widely accepted about different ways in which people might read Genesis chapter 1. And by the century's end, I note that many Protestant Bible interpreters, including the notable Princeton theologian Benjamin Warfield, had come to accept the great age of the earth. close on the heels of the early geological work, of course. Then came the publication of Darwin's On the Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection, 1859. And in the paper, I spend some time looking at the reception of these ideas. Against a background in 19th century Britain, in which Christians, including the great majority of evangelical Protestants, were generally interested in and open to new scientific ideas, many people in Britain took the new evolutionary ideas very seriously and sought to account for the data in ways that were congruent with a Christian worldview. Indeed, the theory of biological evolution could be seen as a welcome development in the world of science because its organicist paradigm was considered to be more congruent with Christian faith than the mechanistic paradigm that had dominated the preceding period. Evolution could be interpreted, was interpreted, in terms of growth toward the fulfillment of a divine purpose. In this context, I mentioned Darwin's forgotten defenders in this time period, those Protestants of evangelical persuasion who defended Darwin not just in Britain, but also elsewhere. We call them forgotten defenders now precisely because the popular contemporary warfare model of science and faith finds no place for them, so they get erased. The story told in that model tends to talk up other figures like Edward Pusey in Britain, Charles Hodge in the US, and John Dawson in Canada. You've probably never heard of him, but I'm Canadian and I'm determined not to let that go without a fight. These three men, very uncomfortable with recourse to the idea of divine accommodation in Scripture when it came to the new biology, although interestingly, not opposed to it when it came to earlier issues. But on this issue, this was a sticking point for them. But I point out that in a European context in which the Darwinian hypothesis increasingly came to be seen as explaining coherently a very large number of data, and doing so more successfully than the competing theory of special creation, and therefore, in a period when it steadily gained support in public discourse as a true hypothesis, that in that context, Pusey's work in Britain on science and faith was destined to have little lasting impact. Dawson's thoughts on science and faith, likewise, generally discounted in his native Canada after his death. Of the three, it's Charles Hodge who has had the greatest ongoing influence in his own country down to the present time, which explains a lot about where the contemporary battles about faith and science with respect to evolution are still being most tenaciously fought. But we should not forget that a very great number of Orthodox Protestant people from the 19th century down to the present have not adopted a Hodgean stance on this issue, but have stood instead with Luther and Calvin and their successors when it comes to the question of which hermeneutical principles we should bring to bear on such questions as we try to read creation and Scripture together. And this brings me to the conclusion of the paper and what we can learn from the past that's useful for the present. I argue here that what contemporary Protestants should learn from all of this is first, that we at least should not continue to deploy a generalized warfare model of the relationship between science and faith. This model does considerable violence to a much more complicated historical reality. And this point of view is widely accepted now by scholars working in the history of science, and I quote a couple of them there just to demonstrate that's the case. Secondly, I propose that as a result of learning about this complicated historical reality, that we need to realize that we, like our forebears, are confronted with a choice. We can certainly adopt a fighting stance if we want to when it comes to Scripture and creation, faith and science. But if that is our decision, we simply cannot take refuge behind either the reformers or most of their immediate Protestant successors or church fathers like Augustine, for they do not, in fact, commend such a stance. That's my firm belief on this point. And the question is, why would we want to adopt this fighting stance anyway? Why would we want to depart from the practice of so many of our significant Christian forebears in taking seriously the evidence for what is true that comes to us from outside the Bible and then wrestling afresh implications for how we understand Scripture on particular points.
That's my question in the paper. Are we really so very sure of our entire infallibility as Scripture readers that we can afford to ignore the warning of those who have gone before us on this very point? And here I quote Thomas Aquinas, just because everyone else has quoted Thomas Aquinas, so I don't want to be left out. One should adhere, says Thomas, to a particular explanation with respect to Scripture, only in such measure as to be ready to abandon it if it be proved with certainty to be false. That seems like good advice. But if we're not open to evidence, how shall we ever come to consider even the possibility that our current interpretation of Scripture is to some degree mistaken? And if love of self is insufficient to persuade us, then I propose at this point, in the spirit of the previous paper, that we need to consider our neighbors. I note that this is actually where Aquinas himself alights as he finishes that sentence of a moment ago. One should adhere to a particular explanation only in such measure as to be ready to abandon it if it be proved with certainty to be false, lest Holy Scripture be exposed to the ridicule of unbelievers and obstacles be placed to their believing. Strong echoes of Augustine there. Historically, the non-integrationist way of doing biblical hermeneutics has only ever provided stumbling blocks for other people. This was already true in the 17th century. It's certainly true now. If the Christian story cannot be shown to be capable of absorbing new truth and making sense of it, what are people supposed to do with that? The choice then, I suggest in the paper, has been and remains either to adhere to the official teaching of the church or your church and ignore the science, or embrace the science and detach oneself from the official teaching of the church. Those appear in that case to be the options. And of course, as we all too readily know, it's the latter one, go with the science and abandon the church, that is largely being embraced in the culture. So I bring the paper to an end finally by exhorting the reader, aka you folks, that if even love of neighbor cannot persuade us that this kind of approach is a wrong approach, perhaps we need to consider also the needs of God's creation at large. And here I introduce my second Bacon, the English philosopher Francis Bacon, and I discuss the way in which in his writings, we begin to see science already beginning to slip its moorings in respect of Orthodox Christian theology in the early modern period and sail off in its own direction explicitly with mastery of creation as the goal. And here, I propose, we see foreshadowed the development of science as a totalizing worldview, in principle independent of the doctrinal and ethical constraints of Christian religion. The world we live in now is the eventual product of this development, and it is not a pretty sight. For what we call science now has all too often sunk, I think, to a significant extent into reductionism, losing its metaphysical and ethical bearings, often in overt reaction to what is perceived as anti-scientific fundamentalism that's unable to accept progress. So once again, the bifurcation of the ways, they feed off each other. To a significant extent, I think we have to acknowledge this is our corporate Christian fault. We're not the only ones to blame, but we are to blame. And for the sake of the world, we need to get our act together. Modernity is not doing well, as well in adulthood as it might have expected when it first began to make off with its Christian parents' wealth in its prodigal adolescence back in the 17th century. It needs some ongoing family support and rebuke. But even to get into the conversation, we need to bring home both the Bacons. Owning Roger's vision of integrated knowledge, gleaned from both of God's books, and corralling Francis's vision of dominion over nature, once again within a more authentic version of the Christian story, where love of God, neighbor, and creation directly informs what dominion means. We really do need, for all these reasons, to retrieve a more authentic Christian approach to faith, science, and Scripture. Thank you.
I wouldn't need pictures either. Mm-hmm. Anyway,
either. So here we are.
As Provan observes, the complaint of Roger Bacon to the Pope rings a familiar bell in our modern world. It is commonplace in many of our churches that science and its discoveries are viewed with suspicion and considered dangerous, threatening to people of faith and contrary to the historic traditions of the faith, as they are so narrowly understood. Provan has restored to us our footing in history by clarifying the perspectives that respected theologians have promulgated throughout the history of the church. Consequently, we have recovered our identity in them and can now be confident that we stand in solidarity with them as we think about science and Christianity. Today, we join with them in sorrow that Christianity is so often ridiculed by the world around us, not for the stumbling block of the cross, but for adopting an anti-scientific perspective. It should affect us deeply to realize that so many in the world around us believe that an anti-scientific posture is characteristically Christian and intrinsic to Christian belief. We have misrepresented the nature of the Bible and the focus of the Bible, and as a result, people misconstrue Christianity and are driven away from it. In contrast to the anti-scientific perspective, I resonate with Provan's insistence that God's two books need to be read together and that the warfare model should be utterly rejected. As he has reviewed for us the tradition of integrating faith and science, attested in a number of the worthy and respected theologians of the past, he helpfully reminds us of a heritage that is often forgotten or neglected in contemporary conversations. In Provan's conclusion, he opines that part of the answer to the rise of what he calls the autonomous scientific monster lies precisely in the 17th century Christian failure or refusal to stand in the line of succession of many of their Christian forebears in seeking an integrative approach to knowledge and in the ongoing popularity of this kind of obscurantism with respect to science in the succeeding centuries. That was a quote of his. It is a sensible assessment and helps us to recognize that the flawed premises that led some in the church to adopt their obscurantist bifurcated positions were driven by, one, a failure to recognize what scripture was and how it worked, and concomitantly, number two, a failure to acknowledge that scripture was given in a particular cultural context and needed to be read as an embedded, situated text. Though often today we may find cause to distance ourselves hermeneutically from some early Christian writers, we can at the same time identify overlapping objectives in Augustine's claim that to discover the will of God in Scripture, we must discover the thought and will of the human authors who wrote it. Unlike Augustine and most other theologians over the last 2,000 years, however, we actually have the means to achieve these objectives that they never could have imagined. We have them due to the archaeological recovery of the literature of the ancient world. These texts give us the unprecedented opportunity to actually understand what Augustine called the will of the human authors, armed with invaluable information about the world in which they lived. God used Israelite human communicators who addressed an audience that shared their culture and language. This communication is therefore inevitably embedded in the ancient world. It does not mystically incorporate subtle but specific information about other cultures in other times, whether that of medieval Japan, Stone Age Borneo, pre-Enlightenment Spain, the Cherokee of the 15th century, or postmodern American culture today, as we somehow seem to think happens. Its form and content are always governed by the Israelite context. Truly, even though it is written for us and for everyone, it is only written to Israel of the Iron Age. This is what Chrysostom refers to as the fleshly garments of human thought and human language. What we and the early Christian writers referred to as accommodation must be viewed as an essential element of any effective communication. Despite these fleshly garments, the revelation of God is sufficient not only to discover the remedy for our human condition, but on the positive side of the ledger, to learn of God's plans and purposes that supersede our desperate plight and help us to comprehend what God is up to, enough at least to participate with him in the great enterprise that he has undertaken, not just to redeem us, but to invite us in as partners in his kingdom work. When I speak to audiences today presenting proposals about how the Israelites would have viewed the origins accounts in Genesis quite differently than we do today, one objection that is frequently raised concerns how God could have left us in the dark for so long. Am I really suggesting that all through the history of the church, we've got it wrong? I believe that this tension is alleviated when we are made aware that even from the earliest discussions, it was recognized that Scripture was designed only to answer infallibly certain kinds of questions and not others. Armed with that knowledge, we can see that even though all interpreters will always be hampered by their lack of information about the cultural context in which Scripture is given, the kinds of questions that Scripture ultimately answers, the information that we desperately need, has never been in doubt. Our current knowledge of the ancient world serves to help us to recognize when we are anachronistically imposing our modern perspectives on the text. We can succeed in at least setting those off to the side in our reading, even if we cannot fully recover the perspectives of the ancient audiences. Despite the challenge of penetrating the ancient world, we are fully in a position to understand, as Calvin indicates, what Scripture is useful for. In our contemporary use of Scripture, we too often casually commandeer it for use in all sorts of capacities that were never intended. It does not offer us scientific knowledge covertly woven between the lines of the ancient biblical text and cryptically addressing the sophisticated issues of today. It does not propose a systematic theology. It does not establish a moral code. It does not help us unravel how to interact with social media. It does not provide a how-to handbook. As one recently published book states in its title, Saving the Bible from Ourselves, how important that is. When we turn our attention to science specifically, we recognize that the scientific method as practiced today, as well as the larger enterprise of scientific investigation, is based on exploration of the natural world as it can be perceived through what we classify as natural laws. We are inclined to differentiate that sharply from what would be classified as supernatural. That is, events that defy natural laws, or at least admit of no easy natural explanation. In contrast, in the biblical world, they had no such categories. God was involved in all events as agent without differentiation of levels of agency. He was just as involved in what we refer to as natural cause and effect as he was in the extraordinary events that continue to defy our attempts to explain as achievable through natural causes. If this is so, then the Bible cannot weigh in on whether anything it discusses should be characterized today as natural or supernatural. If they have no category natural, then the designation supernatural would be meaningless. To draw the fine point then, if science is only engaged in what is deemed natural, and Scripture does not have a category natural, then science and Scripture cannot disagree. Scripture cannot disagree when science claims something to be natural. Big Bang, human origins. When Scripture insists on God's active involvement, it is saying nothing different than it would say for anything that happens. You knit me together in my mother's womb. We try to pluck words like providence and then supernatural, as if there's no room in between. Wrapping up, I'm in full agreement with Provan's conclusion. Quote, we should not continue to deploy a generalized warfare model of the relationship between science and Christian faith to characterize the situation in the history of the church's engagement, end quote. This can be accomplished by fine-tuning our expectations of the Bible. To cite an example, how we label texts can make a difference. What if we started referring to Genesis 1 as a cosmic identity account rather than a cosmic origins account? What if we referred to Genesis 2 as a human identity account and understood that it was dealing much more with anthropology, who we are, than biology, what we came from? Many other strategies might help us turn away from the warfare model with a precedent of respected theologians of the church throughout history to lead us. Nonetheless, we still must address what we should do. How should we interpret the origins account, identity accounts, of Scripture? Granted that the Bible does not teach us science and that what it intends to be useful for is not related to the scientific issues of our contemporary world, we can gladly and freely focus on what the Bible is useful for. Even as we do that, we also must continue to work together to interpret the early chapters of Genesis responsibly, in full recognition of their embeddedness in their particular cultural context. Proper reading of what the text is saying will still result in very important theological insights that will contribute to what the Bible is useful for.
Michelle will take this.
Thank you very much. My name is Jacob Kim. I am a graduate of North Park. I love this school. And I love this conference. Yeah, I totally agree with the integrational approach. My question is, what do you think about this assertion that Bible is not designed to answer certain questions, it is designed to only matter of salvation, morality? Sounds very good, but it gives the impression that Bible is deficient. I think this very looks thoughtful, but very problematic position. I would rather phrase Bible is intended to give the whole truth, entire truth. But just as God left Garden of Eden, not as a ready-made something, but an environment in which human activities, participation could do something great. Garden of Eden was not ready-made. No, God said, you take care of it. Work out, take care of it. You develop art, music. There is a sound, but there is no music. So it's the same thing. So I would rather prefer saying Bible gives answers to all questions, all answers, especially matter of salvation and morality. But it is very condensed, very condensed. So our task as theologians or pastors or gospel workers is to delineate that process, really. For example, in Gospel of John chapter 5, Jesus healed a man who had been invalid for 38 years. His first question was, do you want to get well? Because healing begins with aspiration. Then Jesus says, pick up your mat and work. He gives these steps. Actually, if we delineate it, that's physical therapy. Actually, that's how physical therapy developed. And I personally think that integration, we can do a lot of integration by delineating the difference between biblical worldview and scientific worldview. And this.
Thank you. Well, much of what you said there positively about what we ought to be doing and how we ought to be reading the Bible and so on, I agree with. So we can set that to one side. The question of deficiency, though, has to be measured in terms of the question of purpose and intention. So if I, my wife is abroad at the moment, if I were to do something quaint and antiquarian and write her a letter, and a love letter, saying I miss her and stuff, and I got the reply back, thank you so much for your letter, but it was deficient because it didn't give me any information about quantum physics. I would think that rather strange, because it wasn't part of my purpose to communicate to her anything about quantum physics. What I wanted to tell her was that I loved her. Now, it's a trivial example, but actually it's a good example, I think. The deficiency, it's only deficient if the intention was otherwise and I failed, right? So that just brings us right back to the question, which is, what is Scripture for? And I think it's very striking in 2 Timothy 3:16 that inspiration is immediately and directly connected with usefulness and a list of things that Scripture is useful for, right? So that question of communicative intent is right at the heart of what Scripture itself talks about inspiration being. I don't think there's any reason at all, either biblically or theologically, to think that the Bible intends to answer all questions. I can see no basis for believing so. And I think I have a lot of reasons for thinking that's not the case, actually. So thank you for the question.
Dr. Provan, Mary Chase Solick. I was very intrigued when you were taking us through the history of the church and science, and thinking about, would it be fruitful to also be looking at the corollary between the history of the church and medicine, and which was historically very closely tied in, and thinking of John Wesley's work in writing about and providing healthcare. And so medicine's kind of like an applied science, a way of applying science to personal care. And I would just, I don't know if you have any thoughts about it, but I think it would be a very fruitful corollary to look not only at the historical development of the church and science in general, but also the church and medicine.
Absolutely, thank you. Yes, you could do a number of other things beyond what I'm doing. I'm trying to draw a map that other people can then explore further, a hopefully accurate map. I do think you could plot the same two ways through that story as I have plotted generally. So as I said earlier on, Luther was very enthusiastic about some of the medical advances of his day, and certainly in subsequent centuries, other people were too. John Wesley, a bit like Jonathan Edwards, is kind of lucky he didn't kill himself, because you may know that his practice was to test things out by taking them, so he could then write to his Methodist flock and tell them what happened and recommend various. So he was very into what we would now call holistic medicine. And it wasn't just the souls of his flock he was interested in, it was their well-being, their general well-being, right? It was a very holistic approach to the Wesleyan approach. Now, on the other side of the equation, though, in 1847, my countryman James Simpson proposed that it now ought to be possible to relieve women's pain in childbirth by using anesthetics. A great number of Presbyterian Christians in Scotland thought this was outrageous and impious, because after all, had God not ordained that women should suffer in childbirth, so where are we not now, you know, doing something very impious? So, yes, absolutely you could track. I've just given you a few examples, but for sure you could track it all the way through. And it's interesting to me that we still have this kind of schizophrenia almost on this question of progress. Some parts of progress we really enjoy, apparently, and other parts get selected out for you know. And, of course, I think we should be self-critical and critical of you know, exercise critical judgment. I don't think everything about what's called progress is an unmixed good, for sure. But I suppose what I'd like to see is more coherent thinking about it, rather than just a kind of, I like that, I don't like this,
kind of approach, which I'm afraid is the kind of default position oftentimes in our church communities. So.
Hi, Ryan Thompson, student. I just want to read one of the latter sentences in your paper, which I thought was really great and insightful. We need to bring home both the Bacons, owning Roger's vision of integrated knowledge gleaned from both of God's books, and corralling Francis's vision of dominion over nature once again within a more authentic version of the Christian story, where love of God, neighbor, and creation at large directly informs our understanding of what dominion means and what it is for. So this is like a very lofty, you know, goal, and definitely worthy of our time. But I was wondering if me as a future church planter, like, I'm wondering, how can we, some of us anyway, as ministry leaders, kind of bring this to fruition? Because it's very big, it's very grand, but how do we make it happen?
Well, I think we have to preach the full gospel. We have to have a very broad view of God's plans in the world as involving right relationships with God, each other, and with creation. We have to retrieve what I think is a better and more biblical and more accurate view of what words like dominion mean and how that royal priesthood idea of the image bearer is pretty important to the whole thing. We have to do it, as I was saying to the gathered North Park body the other day there, we have to do it in more than 20-second, 20-minute bursts once a week, because at the moment, most of the folks in our churches are being catechized by the internet and cable TV, and the idea that we can somehow shape their minds, their habits, their thoughts, and everything else in that context with a sermon once a week and probably a pretty poorly led Bible study once a week is ridiculous, and it's a form of madness, I would suggest, actually. So a recommitment to robust educational, Christian educational activity, where it becomes overtly recognized to be scandalous that somebody has an advanced degree in X, but a 101 knowledge of Bible and theology at the same time. That ought to be regarded as profoundly a spiritual problem, in my opinion. So these are all the ways of, I think, that practically speaking. But it begins with the vision, because if you don't have a large enough vision, you won't even bother too much. So as long as we retain this very narrow idea of the Christian faith and life in the first place, the non-integrated, tribal, narrowly focused, inadequate, you know, that nothing will change, because there's nothing there even to prompt people's consciences then, right? So I do think that education is a huge part of it, but of course education even by itself won't help either, because the kindling of desire and will is part of that too. And that's a bit more intangible, but that's the task. And I think it's very much the task that faced the reformers. And their job must have seemed to them vastly more complicated than our job. I mean, they had to invent literacy systems from the ground up and school systems while running for their lives and, you know, generally not in a happy position. So honestly, I think our task is a bit of a breeze, really. But because we've been so comfortable for so long, it feels hard. But that's just because we're wimps, historically. I mean, really, measured against the entire history of the church and the global church at the moment, our whining about how difficult our life is just ridiculous, to be perfectly blunt about it.
I'll try not to whine. My name's Jonathan Wilson. I'm clergy in the area, in the covenant. Thank you so much for this paper. My question is actually piggybacking on what's being said from Mary as well as from Ryan. And it might be going to a place that will sound pretty absurd, but stay with me. I'm not sure that it is all that absurd, but I've done some study. I'm a PhD in church history. And so you're mentioning John Wesley and these others. Well, there are also a large number of obscure pastors who are laying the foundation for scientific disciplines all the way into the early 1800s. Some of them I studied. They're part of the American Philosophical Society. And what I'm wondering is, if what we've seen is a product of the compartmentalization of the academy,
yeah.
and that now with the specializations,
yeah.
all we have time to do is get our divinity degree. And what I'm wondering is this a function of pastors not being in the sciences anymore?
Yeah.
And should the seminary start offering, you know, dual degrees, get your divinity degree and a master's in physics?
Right.
Well, I have two rules of public speaking when I travel abroad. One is never comment on the politics of the country you're in. And the other is never comment on the seminary or the setting that you're in. And so I know nothing very much about North Park except they're lovely people and they always make me feel welcome. So what I'm now going to say has nothing at all to do with any analysis that I have made of North Park Seminary. Having said that, I am not convinced that the way we do church now is adequate for the cultural tsunami we now face. And I am not convinced that the way that we train church leaders, I would rather say educate church leaders, is adequate either. Of all the times in history we've lived in, this is the moment for Renaissance humanist-type pastors, pastor-scholars. Of all the times we've lived in, this is it. Because if our church leaders cannot help people to integrate within a Christian frame, where are people going to go? And what I think happens is that pastors with their own insecurities about these issues simply avoid all this stuff out of healthy self-preservation, right? They don't want to start the conversation because they really don't know where it's going to go. And that might be a bit dangerous. So I actually think that our approach to education is not very good. And worse than that, it's actually getting worse. Because the whole impact of distance education and all that is basically removing people from embodied communities. It is cutting down degrees so they're more affordable. So affordability, accessibility, and all that stuff's now the thing. And I find myself asking, affordable in respect of what, and accessible in respect of what? One of the great things that's happened, of course, is the first casualty is biblical languages. So whereas Martin Bucer could foresee in the Reformation a time when the common language of every Christian city in Europe would be Hebrew, now there's a grand vision. We are running just as fast as we can across the whole of the church in the opposite direction. And we're saying the important things are, and this is just global capitalism taking over your body, it's the body snatchers, right? The most important thing is affordability, accessibility, flexibility. No, the most important thing is a decent education, for gosh sakes. That's what's really important, right? And the more we continue with this madness, I mean, there are multiple madnesses, right? The more we continue with this madness, the worse things are going to get. So we have to retrieve the sheer gut confidence, and we have to reconnect with our Renaissance humanist patristic past, and we have to say, what would any of those guys think now of our educational level if they came among us now? Please, right? So I feel very, as you can see, I feel very strongly about this. And I profoundly believe we're going in exactly the wrong direction. And as long as we care more about the viability of our institutions and finances and stuff, to the extent that we're prepared to sacrifice the depth and breadth and excellence of our education, we do not serve the church locally or globally. So that's what I really think about that.
Aaron Johnson, and I was just wanting to see if we could go in a slightly different direction. We've been talking about within the church, but there's been so much damage between, well, the church and the culture. How do we fix it with the culture? Honestly, like, what do we do aside from try to get the church to be on board with this concept that it's not a war for, it's not a war? How do we bridge that gap?
I don't believe there's any easy answer to that, and I don't believe there's ever been an easy answer to that kind of question. Can you imagine the early Christians asking themselves that question? What do we do about this Roman Empire thing? You know, it seems pretty all-encompassing and all-absorbing, and people believe it, and we're only a few people, and they hate us. So again, we have a small problem here, not a big one. There are certain things we can do. There are certain things that lie within our control. And that is making sure that we ourselves have this large vision of the Christian gospel, that we ourselves get ourselves as educated about as much as we can and relate it to Christian faith, not just so we can articulate to others, but so we can live it better. And that embodied getting on with living and being the church in this full proclamatory prophetic way across the whole breadth of being, such that people say, well, these Christians, you know, they're smart. I don't like them still, you know, and I think what they're saying is dangerous, but I can't deny they're pretty smart and they're really good on the compassion and looking after people. I mean, that's what changed many people's minds in the Roman Empire, right? It was those guys staying with the plague victims in Rome when old Stoics ran away. It was those guys picking babies up off rubbish heaps. That was what happened, right? It wasn't like, you know, from the top down. It was from the bottom up. Ordinary, embodied, caring, compassionate stuff. All of that lies in our control. Nobody's preventing us doing any of that stuff, right? Now, will that make the culture think better of us? Very likely not. Because we're back into the, we all know Christians eat babies, don't we, kind of environment here, right? So it's not just that we are not living and proclaiming as we should. We have to recognize that even if we do, because the culture is running very fast in different directions, it may still hate us. It may hate us more because now we're not such easy targets. Now it's becoming more complicated because you can't accuse people of being stupid or hypocritical. So what you got left? Killing them, probably, which is what happened before as well. So there are certain things we don't have much control over. But there's a whole bunch of things that we have enormous control over. And I actually think we should focus on that and stop worrying so much about the rest of it, to be honest. I mean, what happens out there comes and goes. This election you poor folks are facing will come and go. The church will still be here the day. The church will still be here the day afterwards, right?
No, we're meeting after the day before.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Professor. Actually, this explains a lot for why am I taking this course. As I'm a foreigner, you are a foreigner, so we can speak frankly, basically. nothing bad about this country, but the reality. So the thing, my go to the point, I think the problem is not that we are not shifting quick enough to the need of the society. The problem is we are shifting too quickly. Because we are so focused in the last 20 years to discuss about social science, about how we can impact our community. Suddenly, people pay so much attention to science. Then we need to change the science. The problem is, we are only good in the seminary for 3 years. What do you expect we learn in the seminary? Is we're gonna be mediocre scientists, and we're gonna be mediocre theologians. What good for a mediocre theologian plus a minister in ministry, which is nothing. So we only got this long in seminary. What can we do? I think if you go back to the Middle Ages, the monks were good at science. The monks was leading the science discoveries. So their training was sufficient. It's a lifelong process. It's a capability of study. And yeah. We are trying to squeeze the seminary to become a all-can-do shop. Yeah. And we became the products of all supermans. We are... When you got MD, it's supposed to mean you know everything about ministry for lifelong, which is definitely wrong. Now, my concern is, I'm from a very different background as a Chinese. We go to extremely another direction because we are pretty good at natural science. We recently made the biggest kind of mirror, kind of haruka something to direct it to the space, which is exactly what it is, I do not know. But the thing is, that in our ministry context, we are extremely interested in science. Why? Because basically in our society, science is the new god. Mm-hmm. And everybody worships science. And when you become a minister, the danger is I'm afraid that mediocre pastors, which do not very accomplished in academic in science, trying to big bold claims about theology and science, that is a direction to hell. That I think that if we can continue doing the apostolic job and what is the church supposed to do, passing down the gospel and dialogue with the scientists, we are okay. Yeah. And the reason I'm taking this course is I'm so afraid that in ministry, not in seminary, but in ministry, there's a lot of ministers who making crazy statement about science compromised the gospel, proclaim right. that we need to worship God, and the meanwhile, we worship science.
Yes. Brilliant. Well, I love your passion, and it will stand you in good stead. But let me say something in favor of mediocrity. Mediocrity is better than ignorance, probably, on the whole. Secondly, I do agree with you. I do not think seminaries are designed, nor do I think most of your professors probably think, that they are giving you the final product to take away in your pocket, having paid your money. I think what a good education will do, wherever it is, a good education will give you a great map for your ongoing lifelong journey, which will be, I hope, a lifelong learning journey. If it's an accurate map, if it's a really good map, it will help you really to more coherently put know where to put things as you then encounter them. And I think one of the great problems that confronts pastors with burnout and stuff is because they aren't actually going on learning and being and so on in their own selves as persons. Partly that's the church's fault for ridiculous expectations sometimes. But part of it is also built into the DNA as well. So we do have to be very aware of that. So I see a good education as giving you some very important basic tools, as doing that in a community of people from whom you're learning and being shaped and challenged and so on, so that when you then go to enter a leadership position, you are then able to lead and to model that, continue to grow in your own person and to help other people along the way. We hope, therefore, that the end is not mediocrity, but the end is something greater, and we have reason to think so from a Christian point of view. So the starting points in terms of whether the education is good is, I think, quite important. But I still have this hunch, and you may disagree with me, that even a bad education is better than none. I still think that on the whole, although I've met people who've made me doubt it sometimes. But but on the whole, I still believe that. So.
You guys know me already, John. I've got to hold the laptop sure. for the online people. Just to add another dynamic to the education conversation. I would love for seminary to be 7 years, where I got a master's in physics and a master's in business, and I knew how to run a church financially, and I knew how to exegete Paul and all of these things. But the issue is, right now we're talking about a master's in divinity. A master's that I have taken about a third of it, a little bit more than a third of it here at North Park, and no class that I've taken is even remotely expendable. Every class that I've taken is absolutely essential. And I'm a third way through a master's. If I was to go get my master's in basically anything else, it would take me 2 years online, I'd be done, I'd wash my hands of it, and I'd walk away. Now, I understand that for the purposes of ministry, our calling is different than that. It's a different type of calling. But I feel like the impression of saying, well, we need to add back Hebrew, or we need to add back more classes in preaching, or we need to force people to take more electives in the sciences, is creating a vast burden on people who are already unfortunately behind the eight ball for what a master's is. I recently talked to the somebody at Pitt, the former dean of the seminary, I think seminary at Pitt, who said we should just do away with the MDiv and it should be a doctorate degree, because that's what it is. You're a doctor of this. You're not a master of it. If you still claim that you're a master of it, then you should be thrown in chains. So my question is to you. How would you respond to that? And as an educator yourself, What is to be taken away if we're going to add all of these sciences back in?
Well, let's be clear. What we're talking partly about adding back in is the language in which the larger testament is written. I would have thought that was something more than just an add-on or whatever. I mean, myself, personally. It used to be regarded as indispensable for those who were going to spend their life preaching the word of God to people. I still regard it as that. And I regard it as a betrayal of the Reformation that things should be otherwise, if you want me to tell you what I really think about it. So yes, I mean, to some extent, I sympathize with you in the sense that we all face in our lives constraints, right? And we all have to make decisions about how to divide our time in a complicated world now, for sure. But then, as I've just said, it's not all about what happens at seminary anyway, right? There's nothing preventing you constructing a reading list that's the next thing you do, and there's nothing preventing you putting 10 books on science on that list, or 10 intelligent books on politics, or whatever you want to do. So we shouldn't think that somehow seminary is meant to be the all-providing, omnipotent God, as it were, in a way, that I just come and get from, and that's the end of it. These years that you spend are typically very formative, important years, not least because of who you're doing it with, which is my big thing about distance education, because it's just removing the embodiedness of it all. So that's what really matters. It's the you are doing substantive things, you are picking up tools, but you're learning it in the context of the global historic church. But that's the beginning, it's not the end, right? That's the foundation. And in the rest of your life, you'll find yourself under just as much time pressure and constraint. And how you manage that will actually be a large indicator of your success or failure, and possibly your mental and emotional health. So this is just life. But does it negate anything else we've been saying? No. Has seminary education always involved sacrifice of all sorts of kinds? Absolutely. Am I suspicious of any system that promises you don't have to sacrifice? Absolutely I am. That's a weird thing for a Christian to believe, that somehow my ability to offer you a degree with no pain is considered a good thing rather than an abomination. That is strange, right? And we've got to step back from this. I mean, it may well be that one of the first things we have to do is to bring a biblical theological perspective on ourselves as educators and as students before we start worrying about what to do with the culture. Because we already believe a bunch of dumb things that have nothing to do with a Christian worldview or perspective. Even how we value, how we offer valuations of things is skewed, right? So, yeah, that's how I would answer. You have my deepest sympathy personally, you understand. But I will not back off on what I think the need of the hour is and how much we are not on the right train and how much we've already given up for terribly bad reasons. So.
A word in defense of theological education. And that is simply to say that this is a church issue. It has to do not simply with the expectations of the theological educators, it has to do with the expectations or lack thereof of denominations and their leaders.
Exactly.
The desire to get people through quickly and cheaply, the desire to have people that are not necessarily intellectual giants, but gatherers and developers and so forth, which are good things. The very pragmatic approach that's often required and expected, rather than a formational approach that develops people capable of lifelong learning. Do we as institution, theological seminaries in the United States and elsewhere, Canada, have a lot of problems with deciding who we're going to be and what we're going to be in the future? Yeah, we really do. Mm-hmm. And this is one of the critical times in the history of seminaries, not only here but around the world. And have we been swallowed up by the capitalistic, pragmatic ways of our larger culture? Yeah, Doesn't take too long to see that. But we are facing the kind of pressures that make most of us in theological education, you well know, want to run screaming into the night. Yeah. So just a plea for us to think about how we do this together as church, denominational, institutional bodies, thinking about who it is and who we want people to be. To me, we're not going to solve this as educators by ourselves.
Oh, indeed not. I completely agree with you. Absolutely, I do. Part of the problem is that within our evangelical tradition, there is still in many quarters a deeply rooted anti-intellectualism that goes along with the pietism. That's part of it. Part of it is allowing people who are simply pragmatists to be in charge of stuff, so they have no vision. They're just pragmatists. Only that. I'm not saying pragmatism is a bad thing, you understand. I'm just saying when you dichotomize vision from pragmatism, you also have a problem. But does the church, I mean, this thing about affordability baffles me. The church in the United States of America must be one of the wealthiest organizations in the cosmos of all time. So it's not a matter of lack of money. It's a spiritual problem. It's where the money is going. So, you know, when people say to me, well, you know, it's awfully expensive, theological education. Well, it's only awfully expensive because you guys are choosing to drive that car and eat those burgers and go on those expensive vacations, right? And build the ark. There's $6 million right away. I mean, of course I agree. It's every part of the system we're in, I don't mean society, I mean the church, there's a problem to be addressed, but I would call them spiritual problems. I just find a lot of what's said in defense of what we're doing now to be laughably lacking in any foundation. And I can tell you one thing, distance education is a bit like taking a gun to your own head and just shooting yourself right now. Because that's just a kind of winner takes all at the end of the thing, right? It's not going to help. Not even financially is it going to help. And spiritually, I think it's a disaster. So I'm sorry if I'm treading on toes, but in some ways, I'm going back to Canada tomorrow. And honestly, I don't, at some deep level, I just don't care. So, yeah, I'll hang with you.
Two more hands in the back and then two in the front here.
Okay, so I'm kind of piggybacking on the comments made earlier. So about the stopping war between science and theology, I hear a lot of scholars talking about what that is stopping the war. And I hear a lot about why, because blah, blah. And I read a lot of a long history about the warfare between two. But I hardly hear anyone talking about how, in the way that keep the authority of the Father without compromising the authority of the Father. So I found it rather dangerous, because if you keep saying do something, do, eat, and people are going to eat junk food. So without saying how, because it's dangerous, so my question is, why do you think scholars are not talking about how in the way that keep the authority of the Father utmost important? Mm-hmm. And further, how would you suggest that how we stop the war between the science and theology? I agree with you totally that any war should be stopped. But the most important thing is how, not what or not why.
Yes. So the how of how we bring science and faith together in such a way so as not to undermine the authority of the Father in our lives. I think that's the question as I understood it. Well, it is the very stuff that we are discussing here, I think. That's the very point of the exercise. The first thing is to start discussing it and to get all the information on the table, which we're getting volumes of in this conference. So we're all much better educated than we were yesterday, I think, which is really good. But I mean, of course, The authority question is an interesting one. Of course, every true Christian will want to be living in obedience to Father, Son, and Spirit. Like we take that for granted. But that itself doesn't necessarily get me to the next point about how exactly I read the Bible in every regard, right? So the one is true, and it's about posture, it's about teleology, it's about some really big and important things. But by itself, getting all of that right doesn't itself answer the question, ought I to read this bit of Genesis 1 in this way or this other way, it seems to me. Not by itself. And so we must wrestle with these things. That it must be done is clear. And the history of the whole discussion makes it clear. It ought ideally to be done well, coherently, and in a timely fashion. Right? That's what the history teaches us. Will we make mistakes? I'm sure we will. But I'm always struck by the parable of the fellow who buried his talent in the ground. I'm not sure what is the riskier strategy here. Wrestling with these issues over here, with the possibility of making some mistakes, which will be corrected anyway, probably, if we're doing it together, or not ever discussing it for fear of making a mistake. I rather suspect the second of those is more dangerous, actually. And because I believe that God can take all of our mistakes and does, and weaves them into the tapestry anyway, because I have the story of Joseph to go back to, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. And I don't think any of us intend evil here. We may just not be very good at it. So, you know, it's not even that bad. So with that story as part of Scripture, I'm not sure. I feel we're too fearful on the whole, you know, and not sufficiently and righteously confident in the abilities that God has given us to do the task we have to do, of which this is one. So,
Steve Larson, a student here at North Park. I really appreciate the historical view that you gave us. That is really a great walk in the midst of it. And I think there's been many questions here today about how do we take, the bacon back home with us.
Yeah.
In a way, I feel like we're sitting around in the pub in Dryman and speaking about the Buchanan clan lands and getting ready to go back out, but we forget that the family still hasn't heard this conversation. In that work on the historical side, though, and that's what I want to ask a question on, you spoke about even Luther desiring Hebrew to be a language spoken in all of the cities. We've gone far from that. I enjoy the original languages and make use of that, and yet have younger pastors who say to me often, why do you do that? I think there's a richness and understanding of that. Yeah. We've moved in a scriptural literacy.
Yes.
And I think that's something we haven't talked about yet, is in a sense, how do we raise in a world of sound bites, in a world of tweets, in a world that's moving so much towards, let's just give it to me quick and fast, how do we return to, what would be your recommendations, how do we return to a biblical literacy? I mean, I just go back to World War II, and I was appreciative of your words that saying that in England, the science, scripture isn't a struggle. It seems to be more of a struggle here. Yeah. But I go back to World War II and the battle at Normandy, and some men who were cut off in the battle, all they said is, if not, and it rallied English to come across and rescue them in boats, because they knew that was the same words Meshach, Meshach, and Abednego said to the king, if not, just those words, if not, biblically spoke to culture. That would never happen today.
No.
How do we take, that's what we need to reclaim somehow. Right. What would your recommendation be to pastors to reclaim that biblical literacy again?
Well, I don't think the church as a whole can afford to withdraw from the cultural conversation and just withdraw from technology and all of that. I think that ought to be regarded as a vocation that some people have to take very, very seriously. However, as with all addictions, so I'm doing a great job here of bringing all the papers in. As with all addictions, there are some people who shouldn't be doing stuff, right? And I actually think we're in a situation where a great number of people are addicted to technology, who are being utterly shaped by all of these forces in ways they are not even able to critically to analyze. And I actually think that we have to clear space, first of all, even for quiet reflection to return to our midst. So we're talking about forming habits. I mean, that's not going to happen. If every time I think, I better think about my spiritual condition, no, I'll switch on the television instead, right? We are distracted. There's never been a more distracted society in the history of the cosmos. Well, unless you're the multiverse, it may have happened. But in the history of this universe, there has never been a more distracted culture, right? Now, there are some things that are just so bad and so dominant that you just have to basically say, no, we're going to abstain. We're going to withdraw from that. And I actually don't think that we're going to continue to have very much success with this whole program that I've just been outlining if we're still competing with all of that. So I think we have to have a very robust theology of technology, which I don't see much of. I can't remember a single sermon I've heard, even a sermon in the last 2 years on some of the massive issues now facing us. Huge issues. We're still stuck on whether Darwin was right, but we're about to be in a Terminator 1 scenario. You know, with robots taking over the world, and nobody seems too bothered about that. I'm thinking that's a bit of a scale of, you know, that seems a strange set of priorities to have. So we need to clear space. That's the bottom line. We need to persuade people that discipleship now at this moment requires abstaining from a whole bunch of things that are normal, attractive, and release endorphins. And then with the space, we might then stand a chance of a different hearing, a different seeing, a different set of habits and practices, a different way of being church. Not because it's like the monks in the desert, not because we want to escape from the Roman Empire, but because we want sufficient distance to be able actually to pray for and help the empire. That's why those guys mainly, they get a bad rap, you know. But if you ask what their fundamental motivations were, particularly the ones living in community, they just, you say, we can't help you unless we get some distance here, right? And I actually think we're at that cultural moment. Now, I know that sounds like a big ask, but let me give you a little anecdote on this that might help you. There's a youth pastor locally in Vancouver. And, you know, youth ministry now, there's an awful lot of, you've got to keep the kids happy. If you don't connect with them, blah, blah, blah. And he said, you know what, I'm not going to do that. I'm actually going to make incredibly large demands of the teenagers in my youth group. And we're going to do discipleship here. And honestly, I'm not going to compromise. And I could care less whether they're entertained. We're just going to be Christians. This youth group, like, grew humongously, until the point the parents objected to it because it was producing people who were extreme. Two things to be learned. It's really hard to convince the culture if it doesn't want to be convinced. But the idea that calls for discipleship of that kind can't possibly work in this culture, my intuitions are actually the opposite. I think it's partly because we're not presenting a big enough gospel, a deep enough gospel, a robust enough gospel. This is a large part of why we're losing the young people. And I'm not underestimating all the addictions and everything else, including the addictions to technology. But we have to begin to challenge the things in front of our face, not the things in the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries. The things in front of our face here are these ones. These are the things that's making it hard for the church to be the church and to inhabit this marvelous, grand narrative that we're supposed to be living in. So.
I wanted to kind of go back to the how integration kind of question that's been brought up. One of my observations just about whenever we are addressing the question of integration of faith with science is that oftentimes it appears that science is presented as, well, this is just what we know, or this is what science says, at sort of face value. The question I wanted to... So this is related then to Chris's comment with regards to how do we discern what is the gold that we want to plunder from the Egyptians. I was wondering in particular if you could address the question of provisionality. So Gerald today talked about the different paradigms with regards to cosmology. For us in this sort of multiverse possibility phase, everything sounds really exciting and new and bizarre. But what if we're really actually in the geocentric phase and we just don't realize there's another paradigm that's going to be even more crazy and bizarre? Yeah. But and so that provisionality then, I was just curious what you all thought. How do you take account for that as you do the integration, besides being humble? I think that's probably the one that we would all certainly say. But besides that, in what way would that be a part of, would you propose it to be part of the integration?
Yes. I do think it's important to ask those questions, and it's important to help other people to be critical thinkers about science as well as about scripture reading. So thinking well about these things is important, and recognizing the way in which paradigms change over time is part of being educated about stuff. As to when you know the moment has come, when you've crossed that threshold of evidence, that's a hard one to answer, right? And people criticize each other even historically about this. So you'll hear people say, well, Luther was against Copernicus. Well, most sane people, when Luther uttered those unwise dinner party comments, and by the way, don't allow people to take notes at dinner parties. That's the that's the great lesson to be learned from Luther. When Luther made his rather reckless red wine-inspired comments, very few people in educated Europe would have bought Copernicus at that moment, because there was no empirical basis for it, right? There was a few smart mathematicians who had worked out that this at least was elegant and aesthetically pleasing, but it wasn't really till Newton that the burden of evidence shifted, really. Even Galileo, not really, in my opinion. It's Newton that really is the guy. So there's a good case of blaming somebody in a completely ahistoric, kind of anachronistic way, as if he ought to have known what we smart people here nowadays know, we think. So that's not fair, right? So you're in the stream of history, you're making judgments. I myself, like many of you, have been on this journey. There came a point when it occurred to me, after doing some serious reading and work and conversation, that the theory of evolution actually, broadly speaking, was probably true, right? So a threshold was crossed, and you know, I'm still pretty comfortable with that threshold being crossed. Gerald's stuff and my own question of Gerald earlier would imply that I don't believe we're anywhere close to the threshold of evidence in that case, but it's interesting, and there's nothing wrong with hypothesizing or even speculating for that matter, because sometimes that fuels the imagination and people go and do the work, and lo and behold, here's a gravity wave after all. So that's all good. So there's no really easy answer to that. I think it's much more important for us to be comfortable with our own decisions and those around us and know the reasons for them, and to be able to give an account to other people of how that does in fact merge with our Christian faith. And even if we didn't believe it, we still have to do that. So one of the big beefs I have with some of the young earth people that I know, it's not so much that they believe what they believe, because you know it's up to them. I don't agree with them. But my point is, even if you believe that, do you really want to put it up front at the door of the church, along with John 3:16, and say, yeah, you can join our group, but first of all, you have to believe this rather strange thing that hardly anyone believes. You know, so even from the point of view of loving your neighbor, wouldn't you want to enter the conversation on their ground? You know. So that's a rather rambling answer, but the problem is it's because it's a really difficult question. I don't know how you know, actually. But I think considering the evidence with as good a conscience and with as much information as you can gather, there's no other way of progressing with that question, I think, than that. So.
Thank you.